Shout it out. Good morning, Caring. We ask that you join us in worship this morning. If you're able to rise, we appreciate it. Those at home, you can stand there too. It's fine with us. What a glorious day as we begin worship today.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelled among men, my example is he. The Word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering, anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. The hand that healed nations stretched out on a tree and took the nails for me. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away, rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he arose, over death he had conquered. Now is ascended, my Lord evermore. Death could not hold him, the grave could not keep from rising again. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away, rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. Sins far away, rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day,
Wow. Thank you, worship team. That is truly the freedom that cannot be taken away by circumstances, no matter what they are. I just want to welcome you this 4th of July weekend, and I want to bring you up to speed on a couple things to pray for, and then the worship team will just continue to lead us in expressing our love to the Lord. Hands and feet, they are going out today. This is the first time for quite a while, and they're excited to go out as a team. So they will need help. If we can, a few of us can stick around afterwards, they'll need help loading the van. And then it's a really hot day. So when they're done, they have been out in the heat feeding people and all. And then they roll back with the van in here somewhere, who knows, 3:30, 4, 4:30. If you're willing to come back, if you're going to be available and can come back this afternoon and help them unload, please give Suzanne your number. Beth and I are going to come back. She's just going to text. When they're done, say, hey, we're heading back. She'll shoot a text. Then we can come here and help them unload. That's when they're really dragging. You know, they've had a full day and the van's still full and needs to be unloaded and put away. And that's when they can use some extra hands. So that's going to happen this afternoon. If you can help, let Suzanne know and she will shoot us a text. We'll come back this afternoon, help them unload, and that'll be awesome. We want to pray over them as they go out. I want to give you an update on Rochelle, the other half of our worship leaders, Kendall and Rochelle, a team that leads us in worship. She is still in the hospital. A drain has been put in to drain her appendix off, and they're going to wait anywhere from 6 to 8 weeks because that's how bad a shape her appendix is in. So we want to pray for that to get better so it can be taken out. That's how dicey it is at this point. So I want to continue to pray for her and obviously pray for the Cordy family as they are loving and ministering and praying and waiting with and for their sister and daughter. So keep Rochelle in your prayers. The Barner family, I want to pray. Bob and Cheryl are here this morning. Cheryl's sister passed on into glory this week, and her brother has a mass in his abdomen that is growing. They're not sure exactly what it is, so they're still trying to work through that. He's in a significant amount of pain as well, so I want to pray for that. Lori Sadler had a battery of tests done this week. She's waiting for answers from some of those tests, so I want to pray for that. Virgil is going to have a battery of tests done this week on Thursday, and along with a procedure that's connected with those tests. And then just the ongoing, if you're, I pray that you're on the email list and that you get the prayer journal, and it seems like the prayer updates just come like a battery. So much to pray for. So I just want to encourage you in reading those requests when they come through, and just as the Holy Spirit leads you, you're out walking, drive, whatever you're doing, Holy Spirit will bring to mind various people and various things to pray for, and we'll just be in that spirit of prayer in all the time. Pray, you know, in the spirit on all occasions, and there are plenty of occasions for us to pray for. So let's do that now. Let's pray, and then we'll continue to let the worship team lead us in worship. Lord, we're very grateful this 4th of July weekend that we can stand here, we can worship you, we can broadcast worship through the internet, and we're still allowed to do that. There's still freedom to do that. That is something that we do tend to take for granted. Many countries can't do this, and we do it freely for now. So we give you praise for that, and God, I pray that we don't settle into a complacency in the personal freedom and the comfort freedom that we have in our own lives and our own families, and fail to realize the move that you still need and want to do, and we desperately need you to do in our nation. We are free and we appreciate that, but that freedom is not complete. It's only completed in you. And so we pray that for our nation, the changes and improvements, the healing that needs to happen, that flows from you being the anchor for our freedom. Lord, we pray for hands and feet as they go out. There are people, you know, they're not even interested in the coronavirus. They really don't care much about 4th of July. They don't have any place to stay and they're hungry. And that's the base need that they have. And hands and feet, they're going to minister to them, take food to them, take comfort to them, share very practically the love of Jesus. And pray for great favor, pray for protection in the heat. But God, that you would bless them with great fruitfulness and divine appointments, where as they're giving physical food, they might have opportunity to give spiritual food and pray and share your love with people that are in great need. So bless them and help us come around them to load and unload and give them the hands, the strength, the help that they need. Father, we lift up Rochelle. We recognize on Rochelle and Kendall as sisters, as the worship leaders, there's an anointing you have put on them. And certainly there is a physical reality that we get sick, it's a fallen world, but we also sense that there is an attack on her, on the anointing on them to try and steal that away. And so we pray for your protection spiritually. We pray, God, for you to block the enemy's attack to try and steal, kill, and destroy your anointing on their lives. So block that and bring her back to us. God, bring a healing into her life, and might there be a testimony in the way that she walks through this to the medical community and all those you have divine appointments associated with why you're allowing this suffering in her life. God, there's so much that we need to pray for, so much testing going on, medical challenges, and then ongoing things that are on our prayer journal for families that are facing cancer and battling cancer week in and week out, month in and month out, and that they're listed. And for a friend of Caring Community, John Castle, who is with you now, was faithful here and his body just gave out, and now he's with you celebrating, being with you, a life of faith. God, it's amazing to be part of the family of faith, to know that there are promises, there is truth that sustains us. As the worship team sang, you are coming back. What a glorious day that will be. And regardless of what we face, what pain, what challenge, what change, that is not going to change. That is rock solid promise from you that in you we have freedom and you are coming back for us. So may that be what guides us today in all the challenges that we face, and may that be what we share. What we share with others in our spheres of influence as you give us opportunity, that there is a truth, there is a promise, there is a freedom, there is an anchor that cannot be taken from us. And it is only in the person and the relationship with Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen.
I wanted to share a little bit before we start this next set of songs. It's funny how God works, because I think I picked these songs Sunday last week. And they just, man, you got to know what you believe. You really do. And our family has had an interesting one. Not just us. Some of you have experienced great loss this week alone. And so I was reminded by these songs that if you can remember what you believe, that stands firm no matter what you're going through. The one we just sang, Glorious Day, the chorus, living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away, rising he justified freely forever, one day he's coming, oh glorious day. Very similar to what we're about to sing about we believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and he's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and he's coming back again. That's good theology. That's good things to believe. Probably why my dad loves We Believe so much. He's a big theology guy. But these songs, if you have that solid foundation, that's why Pastor Pat and Pastor Sheldon have been preaching it so much, because you gotta have it. Because whether it's stormy weather or sunny weather, where God gives you a little glimpse of hope and restoration, or whether he's healing or whether he's not, you have to have the foundation. And if you can keep that, and you can keep that in your mind, that can be going with you throughout all that you have going on. I'm not going to say much more because it's a lot for me. But while we're singing this song, there might be something about God that you know is true, but you're having trouble believing it. Take it to him. If you're at home, it's fine. You'll buy your couch or your bed, wherever you're at, the kitchen table, that works too. Take it to him. My sister challenged us to lament to God about things a couple weeks ago. Do that, if that's what you need to do. Lament to him about our country and the state that we're in. Because if we believe what we believe, we're the light into the world, and we can shine that too. That's all I'm going to say, because that's enough.
So if you can stand and sing with us, and I can tell you right now, I'm going to count on you to really sing, okay?
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe, we believe, in this broken generation. When all is dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe, we believe, we believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations, we believe, we believe, we believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. So let the lost be found and the dead be raised. In the here and now, let love invade. Let the church live loud. Our God will say, we believe. We believe, and the gates of hell will not prevail, for the power of God has torn the veil. Now we know your love will never fail. We believe, we believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection. And He's coming back. He's coming back again. He's coming back again. We believe. We believe.
Victory is yours.
the Father's plan. You're sending us out light in this broken land. All authority, every victory is yours. Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all our praise, you overcame. Jesus, awesome in power forever, awesome and great is your name. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all our praise, you overcame. Jesus, awesome in power forever, awesome and great is your name. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. Speak what is true, 'cause I am found, I am yours, I am loved, I'm made pure, I have life, I can breathe, I am healed, I am free. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, I am found, I am yours, I am loved, I'm made pure, I have life, I can breathe, I am healed, I am free, 'cause you are strong, you are sure.
Lord, your presence is awesome today. We can feel it. We ask that it will continue to be with those facing some surgeries and some tests. We ask that it would prick the heart of Pastor Pat as he searches the scriptures, and I know he's going to tie it in with our country. And I ask that this time would be your time, that every word would be understood clearly. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Thank you, worship team. You know, that is our response. Our response to God's word, our response to God's offer, our response to God's move is to offer our bodies as living sacrifices. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my life, Lord. Speak what is yours, what you want. And that is certainly an appropriate cry for what we're facing in the days right now in our country and days ahead. As Kendall was talking about a foundation, what we believe, just want to let you know, Sheldon's back from his motorcycle ride in Tennessee, safely back, and had an opportunity to ride motorcycles and minister to his friend with cancer. He will be preaching next Sunday. And then the Sunday after that, I want to make you aware, I'm going to talk about what we believe. I'm going to preach on what we believe, what the Bible says about gender and sexual expression. A lot of confusion, a lot of heartache, a lot of pain. And so I just want to give you a heads up. So if there's somebody you think, hey, I really think that person would benefit from hearing from this, or I'd like to sit with them, or you want to invite them to your place and live stream it. However you think that's going to land. So in 2 weeks, going to preach on what we believe about gender and sexual expression. So just be aware of that, and please be praying for me, for that message, and for how God wants to use that to bring healing and set people free.
Speaking of freedom, it's a beautiful thing. I love it. It's great. 4th of July weekend. This is traditionally a weekend when you will hear people say, so what are you doing for 4th of July? And what they usually mean by that is, you know, are you going to cook out, or are you going swimming? And, you know, what we've kind of heard this year is, where are you going for 4th of July? Because people, there's this sense that, man, I'd like to get away. I don't care whether it's to the beach, whether it's to the mountains, to go camping. I don't care where it is. I'd just like to get away. We've had stay-at-home mandates. We've had social distancing. We've had masks. We've had temperature scans. We have been Zoomed every which way you can be Zoomed. I mean, we've been Zoomed to death. And then on top of that, we've had some protests. Some are appropriate. We've had violence. That's not appropriate. We've had anger, division, destruction, frustration. A lot has happened in the last 3.5 months. And there is a sense in many, a sense in even us, is like, man, I need some freedom from this, right? I get away. Well, I was doing a prayer walk. Just the place we live in, Rockledge, is really conducive to that. And I was doing a prayer walk about this message, about today. And God laid this on my heart to share with you. It is very important that we recognize the reality of two kinds of freedom, especially 4th of July weekend. It's very important that we recognize the reality of two kinds of freedom. First freedom, political, military, governmental freedom. That is a freedom that's the structure under which a people live, whether it is communism, whether it is socialism, or whether it is Republican freedom, like we have. The Republic freedom, that's a representative government that we have. It's the structure under which we live in this world. And that freedom, governmental, military, political freedom, is freedom that is temporary. It is temporary. It is circumstantial. You can have it, and you can lose it. If the circumstances change, the freedom that you have can change as well. So that's the one kind of freedom. Then the second kind of freedom is spiritual freedom. That freedom is, it gives a different order and way for us to live. This is eternal. It is not dependent upon circumstances. It is an anchor on which we can build our lives. It is independent, if you will. True independence. It's independent of circumstances and situations, because that freedom, that second freedom, is freedom we find only in Jesus Christ. And when you have it, it cannot be taken away, no matter what happens in the earthly realm in which we are currently living. There is a song that actually Kendall sent it to me. It's probably you've probably heard it before, but you've probably not heard this particular rendition. It's a song called God Bless the USA. This particular rendition is done by Greenwood, who is, I think, the original one who sang it. But Ed is a country western group, so if you guys are in that genre, you'll like this part. Awesome. There you go, thank you, I knew Sheldon would. It's a group called Home Free, and then added a group of soldiers called the Singing Sergeants. So this song is done by all three of these groups blended together. God Bless the USA. Have a look and listen. All right.
If tomorrow all things were gone, I'd work for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today,
where the flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that away.
Forget the men who died, who gave that right to me.
'Cause there ain't no doubt
I love this land. God bless the USA.
God bless the USA.
From the lakes of Minnesota
to the hills of Tennessee,
across the plains of Texas, oh, from sea to shining sea,
from Detroit down to Houston,
and New York to L.A.,
where there's pride in every American heart,
and it's time we stand and say,
y'all awake? Got God bumps on that one. God bless the USA. He has. But the freedom that we have, the identity that we have as a free nation, is founded in the spiritual freedom that comes from Jesus. And ongoing changes, improvements that are needed in our country, they need to be linked to the spiritual freedom that we have in Jesus, or we will cease to be the America that we sang about. We'll cease to be that nation. If we lose the spiritual freedom, America may continue to be a nation, but we will not be the same. We will not be the shining light that the founders envisioned. President Ronald Reagan said this: "Freedom is a fragile thing and is never more than one generation away from extinction. It is not ours by inheritance. It must be fought for and defended constantly by each generation, for it comes only once to a people. Those who have known freedom and then lost it have never known it again." So let's look at the foundation for our freedom. Let's look at the foundation, which is spiritual freedom first. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 3. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, we're going to start with verse 7. I'm sorry for now, we don't have the Bibles placed in the chairs for you, because then we got to clean them all, you know, all that, so... Bring your own weapon. Hopefully all have a weapon anyway. If you don't have a weapon, Seashell to me, we still have them here. And we'd be happy to give you one. If you know if someone needs one, we'll give you two. If you know of many people that need one, we'll give you five. We'll give whatever you need. Okay. 2 Corinthians 3, start with verse 7. "Now if the ministry that brought death, which was engraved in letters on stone, came with glory." Paul is writing to the church. He's talking about the Ten Commandments. He's talking about the law, what's called the Old Covenant. That's what he's referring to. "If it came with glory,
so that the Israelites could not look steadily at the face of Moses because of its glory, fading though it was. Okay, so the Old Testament, the law came with glory. If you read in Exodus, when Moses went up the mountain was in, was enshrouded in a cloud, and the mountain shook, and there was smoke and fire. I mean, it was the law came with glory. It was from the Lord, so it came with glory. But verse 8, but will not the ministry of the Spirit. So the law points to a new ministry that's coming, guided by God's Spirit. Will not the ministry of the Spirit be even more glorious? That's a rhetorical question. Paul is saying the answer is yes. The new covenant is even more glorious than the old covenant. If the ministry that condemns men is glorious, how much more glorious is the ministry that brings righteousness? For what was glorious has no glory now in comparison with the surpassing glory. And if what was fading away came with glory, how much greater is the glory of that which lasts, that which is eternal? So the law, the Ten Commandments, they're the foundation that paves the way for the freedom that we have in and through Jesus Christ. That's the new covenant. The law condemns. What do you mean by that? God, yes, the law condemns because it establishes a standard, and it is a standard which in our own strength, not a single one of us can live up to. So when you look at the law, you go, that's God's standard. You stand before it in your own strength, and you go, I'm condemned. Every single person is condemned. No one in their own strength can live up to the Ten Commandments, up to God's law. It's what Romans chapter 3, verses 19 and 20 says. Romans 3, 19 and 20. Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, which is everybody before they come to Christ, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world held accountable to God. That's what the law was established for, to point us to the fact that apart from what Jesus did on the cross, we are all condemned. We are all in the same boat, and that boat is sinking. Okay? That's the condition we're in apart from. That's what the law points out to us. Therefore, no one will be declared righteous. Righteous meaning to have right standing with God, to be in an intimate relationship with God. No one will be declared righteous. You can't have that by obeying the law, because you can't. I can't. We don't have that ability. By the works of the law, rather through the law, we become conscious of our sin. The law points us to the fact that we are fallen. It's glorious. The law is glorious because it came from God to reveal our sin. That's his agenda. That's his heart. The whole point of it was to reveal to us our need for a Savior. In Romans 7:13, Paul writes to the church of Rome, he says, the law is good. The law is a glorious thing. But it is incomplete in terms of what is going to be salvation for us. The law condemns. Grace through Jesus brings righteousness. It brings freedom from sin. And that is eternal. That's eternal. That's our hope. Jesus is our freedom. So let's pick it up in verse 12. 2 Corinthians 3, verse 12. Therefore, because of that, since we have such a hope, that's our hope. Our hope is not in the fact that somehow in our own effort we can attain to the law. We can't. That's hopeless. There's no hope in that. But we have a hope in Jesus. We are very bold. We are not like Moses, who would put a veil over his face to keep the Israelites from gazing at it while the radiance was fading away. Now, it's a very interesting thing. We tend to think, well, Moses came down from the mountain and he put a veil over his face to keep people from looking at the radiance of God, because the radiance was so powerful, if they looked at it, they would die. It's not why he did it. He did it because in our own strength, what the law would do is you'd have to make sacrifices, then your sin was forgiven, and right after that you would sin, and then again you'd have to bring sacrifices. So the glory of being forgiven immediately started to fade. And he didn't want people to see that as glorious as the law was, as he walked down the mountain, it was fading. So he covered his face, because only the glory only remains and gets stronger in the freedom of Jesus. That's the point he's making. The glory of the law points to our inability to keep it, And that glory is fading. Verse 14, but their minds were made dull, for to this day the same veil remains when the old covenant is read. It has not been removed because only in Christ is it taken away. Even to this day, when Moses is read, a veil covers their hearts. But whenever anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is spirit, and where the spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is liberty. And we who with unveiled faces all reflect the Lord's glory, we are being transformed into his likeness with fading glory? What? Ever-increasing glory. So Moses in the law, his glory, as soon as he came down the mountain, his glory was fading. When you come to Christ, the glory starts, but it doesn't stay there. As you walk with the Lord and as you allow him to transform your life, the glory increases in your life. That's freedom. Cannot be taken away. Which comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. Now it's interesting that they're dull. Here's what the word dull means. The word dull means blinded, callous, hardened, to lose understanding. Why would they do that? They would do that because they became frustrated by the fact that we can't, according to the law, which they would still read, the law doesn't provide that righteousness for you. You can't earn your way to righteousness. So the more you try to earn your way in your own strength, I can be good. I'm good enough to be accepted into heaven. That's what we hear all the time in our culture. Do you believe in heaven and hell? Well, no, not really. Well, when you die, where do you think you're going to go? Heaven. Well, why do you think you would get there? Because I've lived a pretty good life. We're still stuck in that. We're still stuck in that. That's dull. Our minds have been dulled. It's still what the culture believes to this day. And what happens is when that frustration continues, it doesn't stay there. It builds. It goes from frustration to agitation. It goes from agitation to rebellion. Because according to the law, you can't live up to it. So what do we have to do? If we're not going to turn to the Lord, we've got to get rid of the law. We don't want it pointed out that we are in sin. We will decide, go back to Genesis 3, we'll decide for ourselves what is right and what is wrong. And I don't want the law, the Ten Commandments, plastered on every government building throughout the land to remind me that I'm a sinner. That has to go. That's where it came from, right here. Our minds became dull. Dull. Blinded to the way of freedom. Because freedom is not from a government. Freedom is in Jesus. It is from Jesus. And only in Jesus is that frustration of not being able to be righteous in your own strength. Only in Jesus is that agitation, that rebellion, that blindness, that sin. Only is it taken away in Jesus. So what is the needed response? The needed response is turn to the Lord, when anyone turns to the Lord. Romans 8, verses 1 and 2. Therefore, there is now no condemnation. Where does condemnation come? From the law. The law condemns. When you turn to the Lord, there is now no condemnation for those who are Americans. Not what it says. For those who are French. Not what it says. For those who are Indian. For those who are Chinese. No, nationalities don't pull this off. You can't. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit that gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. That's where it comes from. We're set free. So the law can't do that. The law merely points out the fact that we need it. But it can't accomplish it. It's the Spirit of the living God at work through Jesus that brings that freedom. It's what he talks about at the beginning of chapter 3. Just peek at the beginning of chapter 3 of 2 Corinthians, verses 2 and 3. He's talking about the effect that this church, the Corinthian church, has had when he's preached to them, the effect of the gospel. 2 Corinthians 3, verse 2. You yourselves, the church, you are our letter, written on our hearts, known and read to everybody. So in other words, I live Christ, I share Christ with Stan, Stan gets saved, he starts to live Christ, and he is a letter, he's an expression of what I've shared with him. He shares it with Tommy, and Tommy comes, Tommy accepts Christ, and the letter, the expression of the move of God, spreads. And it came from Grant, your brother, who invited you. See how that works? It's the spread of the gospel message. That's how it works. He says, that's the power, that's the expression. You show, you demonstrate that you are a letter from Christ. I may share it with you, but it's not, you don't follow me, you follow Jesus. All right? We, one another, lead one another to follow Jesus. Okay? The result of our ministry, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God. Not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of human hearts. This is the prophecy of Jeremiah 31. The prophecy of Ezekiel 36, come to light. You know, right? He will write them on their, it's he'll write on their flesh. He'll turn their hearts of stone to hearts of flesh. It's not the law anymore. This is what comes in you and changes you. The law cannot do that. Only the Spirit of the living God through Jesus does that. That's our freedom. Let's go back to verses 17 and 18, 2 Corinthians 3. Back to 17 and 18. Now the Lord is Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Freedom. And we who with unveiled faces all reflect. So what, right? We're a letter. We reflect. You echo what you have. Okay? We reflect the Lord's glory. We are being transformed into his likeness with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Freedom. The Greek word eleutheria, I didn't put it up there because it's really hard to pronounce and you don't care about that. But you care about what it means. Liberty, freedom, liberty to do or to admit, omit things having no relationship to salvation. So in other words, you are not free to decide for yourself how salvation happens. That's Genesis 3. God has decided this is how you are saved. There is one way and one way alone. Not what Jesus said. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. That is established. There's no wiggle room there. But outside of that, we have great freedom. You have great freedom. Well, so people have thought, well, that's great. I can do whatever I want as long as I believe in Jesus. But that's not what the second part means. See, when you understand the freedom you have in Christ, true liberty is living as we should, not as we please. Now, here's the ironic part about this and the great blessing in the power of freedom. When you are free in Christ, you actually live more in line with the Ten Commandments than you would if you tried to live them out in your own strength. That's what you do. Because the more you love Jesus and you understand his grace, the more you want to live an obedient life that lines up with what he's been asking us to do all along. You just can't do it in your own strength. You can't do it. Why? Why? Because here's how it happens. We are being transformed. It is a process. Being transformed by his power, by his presence in us, the Holy Spirit, into his likeness with ever-increasing glory. So you should not be the same believer today as you were 5 years ago. Right? Because if we're walking with the Lord and we're open, as the worship team sang, here's my heart, Lord, speak what is true. The implication of that is he's going to speak things into us that have to be transformed. And so this stuff that was transformed 5 years ago, okay, I'm working on that. But now 5 years later, there's this other issue. Yeah, but God, I did that. I know you did that. Now I'm going to work on this so that you walk with ever-increasing glory. Can I tell you something? We're not done. We're not. You just got something done. You go, praise the Lord, I got this conquered. I'm done. I can coast for a while. Yeah, you can coast for a very short while. God will let you coast a little bit. It's called Elim. There's a little oasis when they were coming out of the promised land. He let them get to Elim as water, and they said, let's land here. Let's stay here. And he's going, no, you've rested enough. We are going to the promised land. And we want to rest with the progress we've made and go, I'm okay. God goes, you are okay. You're just not finished. So we're going to work on the next thing. Okay, that's being transformed with ever-increasing glory. And his character and his presence helps us live as we should, not as we please in the flesh. Our founding fathers had a strong sense of the need for ongoing transformation. They did. They actually wrote it. Dr. Patrick Oliver is a professor of criminal justice at Cedarville University in Ohio. He happens to be a black man. He served 27 years in law enforcement, including chief of police in three Ohio cities, including the city of Cleveland. Here's what he writes. I'll put my specs on. I really want to get this right. The Constitution of the United States is based on the principles articulated in the Declaration of Independence. The Declaration is a non-binding document that expresses the Judeo-Christian principles our constitutional republic is based upon. The Declaration, he writes, was signed by 56 men, 29 of whom had seminary degrees. So over half the signers had seminary degrees, and not some seminaries like we have today, where they're going, here, come to seminary and understand that this is no longer valid anymore. We're deconstructing the Bible and all of the stories of the miracles. They're just sort of myths and illustrations. And that's not the kind of seminary they went to. The seminaries they went to believed in the truth of God's word, like Harvard, Princeton, and Yale. That's right. Harvard, Princeton, and Yale were actually universities founded on Christ-centered principles. Now, you actually have to go to court to have any kind of Christian group on those campuses. That's how far we've come. They're being kicked off of the campuses of Harvard, Princeton, and Yale. You see, what the founding fathers understood, they understood that they were forming something that would need to continue to be changed, but only under the principles of the transforming truth and power and presence and character of Jesus. This is crucial. We understand that that's what they understood would be a guide to a developing nation. Here's what the preamble to the Constitution says. They snuck it in here. They didn't sneak it in here. They boldly wrote it in here. By the way, when's the last time? I haven't read this. Well, I read it recently because I was studying, but I haven't studied this stuff for 50. I learned this in ninth grade, 50 years ago. Is it even taught in ninth grade anymore? Eighth grade? Civics class? Do we have a civics class? I don't even know. I learned it 50 years ago. Preamble to the Constitution. We the people of the United States, in order to what? Form a perfect union. It's not what it says. It says a more perfect union. We'll come back to that. Establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity. Do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America. They were forming something that was superior to what they had under King George III. They were forming something that was better than what they had in Britain. But America would need ongoing power of the gospel to sustain this nation that they formed. It would need to continue to grow and change. They realized there was a more perfect union than Britain, but it was not perfected yet. It would need ongoing change and improvement, but only guided by the structure and principles of a Christ-centered life and law. We have to return to that. We have to, or we're lost. We're lost. They knew we would have to continue to be transformed, to be led by the principles, the character, the truth, the presence of Jesus. Patrick Henry wrote this on the founding of our nation. It cannot be emphasized too strongly or too often that this great nation was founded not by religionists, but by Christians. Not on religions, but on the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's what he wrote, Patrick Henry. We are not a perfect union. We weren't then. We're not now. We are being formed. We're being formed. On July 2nd, 1776, Congress voted to approve a complete separation from Great Britain. 2 days later, July 4th, the early draft of the Declaration of Independence was signed. You know who signed it? It's not a quiz. I had a quiz 50 years ago. I'm not sure how well I did on it back then, but it was only signed by two people. The original draft on July 4th, 1776, was signed by John Hancock. He was the president of Congress, and by Charles Thompson, who was the secretary of Congress. They're the only two guys that signed it. 4 days after that, July 8th, when everybody else jumped in. Members of Congress took that document then, and they read it aloud from the steps. Right, right? Rocky wasn't there. Rocky was not there. He read it from the steps of Independence Hall in Philadelphia, proclaiming to the city of Philadelphia freedom, after which the Liberty Bell was rung. And this is what is written around top the Liberty Bell. Come on, Marla, work with me. There it is. We got a timing thing between us. It's all good. Their air conditioning broke, by the way, at home. That's why Marla's, just pray for her. Okay, Leviticus 20. This is what's atop the Liberty Bell. Proclaim liberty throughout the land and to all the inhabitants thereof. Scripture. Do you know that the quotations that are in the founding documents, 34% of the quotations are scripture? For those who are saying, the founding fathers didn't want anything to do with God and government, are you kidding me? They embedded it right in it. They embedded it in. Now, after they proclaimed this on the steps of Philadelphia, was everybody free? No. No. But it was the target. It was the guiding principle for this new foundation for a nation being formed. Less than 100 years later, Abraham Lincoln declared the Emancipation Proclamation. Was everybody immediately free? No. It was progress. It was a step. We were making progress, transforming. Then with the 60s came the Civil Rights Movement. Was everybody free? No. We were being transformed. We were making progress. Can I tell you, that's still needed today. We still need to make progress. There are still changes needed. We need the transforming work of Jesus, of his truth, his power, his presence and character. There is still racism. There is still prejudice. There's still oppression. There's still corruption. There's hands and feet going out today because there's still abject poverty. There's improvement that's needed. There's still, by the way, do you know that all during this shutdown, do you know what wasn't shut down all during this time? Abortions. The figures that we are aware of is that during this time we've tracked the COVID-19 deaths. There have been a minimum that we can track 3,000 abortions during this time in Pennsylvania. Lord, forgive us. Just Pennsylvania. Okay, we need improvement. We need change. Planned Parenthood has never been shut down during this time. And if you go back to their established record, I'm not talking conspiracy theory here, their established record by Margaret Sanger. Planned Parenthood was established. One of the goals was to accelerate the decline and eradication of the black race. That's one of the stated, that's the record of Planned Parenthood. We need change. We need things improved in this nation. Let's add to that the sexual slavery in this country. People are being bought and sold. Human trafficking is a huge issue in our nation. We need improvement. Part of it is tied to the explosion of drug use in our country. Many of the women that are enslaved in drugs as well. And because of the prostitution and the sexual slavery, then they are having abortions over and over and over again, shortening their lifespan, taking their lives from them. There's improvement that's needed. There's healing. There's justice that is needed. The chains of pornography. Do you know that the pilgrims, when they came to America, the pilgrims stood on the shore of the Atlantic and looked back over the world, and they said, in this new world, we covenant with you, God, that your glory, that the gospel of Jesus will go to the world from these shores. That was their, were you taught that? That's what the pilgrims said. That's what they said. Do you know right now what we're the number one exporter of? Pornography. Instead of the gospel going to the world, we are sending pornography to the world. We're the number one exporter in the world, on the planet. Some things need to change. Some things need to heal. We are not done. We're not done. But just as the nation, we as believers are not done either. See, we can't say, oh, it's America. We are America. So where are you not totally free today? It's the goal of Jesus' work in your life that you will be free. What is it that you're carrying that he wants to free you of? Are you letting Jesus' love, his truth, his power transform you? Or have you pushed him away? You can't have access to that in my life, Lord. In John 8:32, Jesus says this, you shall know the truth. We know this one, right? You shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. That is for salvation, but it's not just for salvation. That's the foundation, is that you would know the truth, that you need a Savior, and you start there, but you don't finish there. It's also for the ongoing transformation, for our freedom, so we have ever-increasing glory. Where are you holding on to your wounds, to your oppression, to the bitterness, to the unforgiveness, to the bondage, to the sin, to the chains that bind you? Where are you holding on to that? Jesus says, I want to free you from that. Because you echo what you have. I want to free you from that. Where are you medicating your life? With all kinds of choices to medicate, with answers that as you sit here today or you listen online, you know that is not Jesus' way. Not what he wants for you. It's what the worship team sang. Here's my heart, Lord. Will you surrender? Will you open up? Here's my life, Lord. Here's my passions, Lord. Here's my pursuits, Lord. Here's my agenda, Lord. Here's my plans, Lord. Speak what is true. Speak you, God. Speak you to me. Galatians 5:1. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. He was talking about the Jews who wanted to make them obey Jewish law, and they didn't have to do that. But it's much broader than that. It's anything that would keep you from the freedom of Jesus. John 8:36, Jesus says, so, if, and in this place, if can be translated since the Son sets you free, that's the reality. That's your position with God. You are free from the ravages, from the promise of the judgment that's going to come on sin. You're free from that. If the Son sets you free, by the way, you are free indeed. Indeed means the practical outworking in your everyday life. That's what he wants for you. That's the target. That is true independence. That is true freedom. And that is what we share with others. So I would like to close. I'm going to try this. It's a little tricky here. Pull my iPad. But I have Beth and I are still part of and some others, of what's called 714 Unite. And it's based on 2 Chronicles 7:14. And so every week they send us a new prayer. You know, 2 Chronicles, if my people call by my name, will humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, I'll hear from heaven, heal their land. I'll answer. This is the prayer for this week. Just came. I want to close with this, and then the worship team will come and we'll close. Heavenly Father, our world has been shaken by multiple crises. We are suffering in many ways, physically, mentally, economically, medically, socially. Ancient wounds and divisions between nations, generations, people, and tribes have been freshly revealed amidst these challenges. With everything in turmoil around us, we stand and worship you. We are grateful that even when we are being shaken, you have placed us into an unshakable kingdom. Lord, we thank you for placing us in your unshakable kingdom. Fill us with peace, faith, hope, and joy as we worship you. Heal the deep divisions fracturing our world, and I would add, fracturing us internally. Today we stand in the gap for the cities, nations, and peoples of the world. Raw pain and hopelessness lie underneath the divisions fracturing us. Make us ambassadors of reconciliation and beacons of hope as we walk in your love and proclaim your word. That's why we need to be free, because we echo what we have. We believe for a fresh outpouring of your Holy Spirit. Revive your church and bring salvation to millions. Lord, empower us to both live and proclaim your word. We come before your throne with one voice, boldly asking for a fresh outpouring of your Holy Spirit, Lord. Please bring revival to our cities and lands. In Jesus' name, amen. Worship team.
If you're able, we ask you to stand again as we close with enough, because you are enough to help us with this challenge today.
Supply my breath of life, still more awesome than I know. You are my reward worth living for, still more awesome than I know. And all of you is more than enough for all of me. Your love and all I have in you is more than enough. You're my sacrifice, my greatest prize, still more awesome than I. You're my coming King, you are everything. Still more awesome than I know, and all of you is more than enough for all of me, for every first and every need, you satisfy me. Your love and all I have in you is more than enough. More than all I want, more than all I need. Yeah, you are more than enough. More than all I know, more than all I can see.
more than enough for all of me, for every thirst and every need. You satisfy me with your love, and all I have in you is more than enough.
He is more than enough for the true independence that you and I need in our own lives. He's more than enough for the changes and improvements, the true independence, the revival we need in this nation. So let him do it in you and me, and then let's be the agents of change for our nation. Amen? Amen. They have hands and feet, needs help, load in the van. Let's help them get to it. Thank you, guys.